and New Lion, the NAIA's official video streaming provider. Turbo Sports Group, the official video production company of this year's national championship. Don't forget, fans, you can purchase a video download of any game from this year's national championship games with video and audio commentary available. Visit TSG online at www.turbosportsgroup.com. And glad you're joining us. This is Josh Brown. I'm joined in the booth by Matt Mahoney, who will be doing the color commentary today. Matt, how are we today?
Josh, I'm doing very well today. Beautiful temperatures here in southern Alabama. A lot of energy in the air. One game in the book. Game two of the entire tournament. The 16-team field is going to happen this afternoon. And we'll find out perhaps who the best team in this entire tournament is here this afternoon with number one Grandview. We'll have a great sight here in the press box.
Yeah, and it has warmed up since this morning. We thought we were going to get some rain. It stayed clear so far, and it's actually shining brilliant sunlight down onto the field right now, and I just had to take off my jacket because it's gotten a little bit more hot here. And as you mentioned, Grandview, the number one seeded team, they're facing off against the number 16th seed, Martin Methodist from Tennessee, Grandview out of Iowa. And we had a barn burner of a game earlier, a Baker facing off against Ashford, and I had the color commentary call with Todd Panula, who was doing play-by-play, and Baker almost came back, and then a last-second goal from Ashford propelled them, and they wouldn't be facing up against one of these two teams, but it'll be interesting to see how good Grandview is living up to that number one seed.
No Cinderellas were invited to this tournament at all. Most all the higher seeds made it here to the national championship site, so what's interesting here, any quote-unquote upset, which is a lower seed taking on a higher seed,
yeah,
you really see if that Cinderella slipper fits right after the game. I mean, there's no time to wait. The storylines will emerge here from Montgomery. Not a whole lot of telltale signs coming into. So it's kind of the game will be determined on the field, which is obviously how you want it to be with the best teams in the country colliding here in Montgomery, Alabama.
Yeah, and as we saw with Ashford, who was the higher-ranked number four seed, they had to scrape for everything they got and barely came away with a win against Baker. And Baker also a good team. None of these teams coming in lightly. The only unseeded team, in fact, is Indiana Wesleyan, who will face off later today against Lindsey Wilson.
And that Indiana Wesleyan team get to play at home in the opening round. So whether it was an upset or not, maybe on paper,
yeah,
yes, but you obviously have the advantage playing at home. And so this game here with the team in Martin Methodist, don't overlook them, because clearly if they can beat them top seed, now they're the Cinderella slipper, the Cinderella story, so to speak. But this Martin Methodist team comes out of the Southern States Conference, the SSAC, or some people call the Super Soccer Conference. So we'll find out here today for sure.
We will indeed, and we will do a national anthem, so we'll part way for that. All right, and with the national anthem being played, we'll prepare to get underway. The starting lineups for both teams. first for the Grandview Vikings. We have Eric Hundevad from Burnsville, Minnesota. He'll be starting as the goalkeeper. We have Rafael Nascimento. He's a defender from Brazil. Ross Alexander, junior from Scotland. Ross Galbraith, defender from Scotland. Gustavo de Souza, another defender from Brazil. Aaron Scott, midfielder from Scotland. Brian Lee, midfielder from Scotland. Johnny McAdam, also from Scotland, a midfielder. Andrew McLevy, a forward. David Machizu from Slovakia. And Ryan McGowan, midfielder from Iowa.
Common theme you'll find in all of these NAIA specialty teams in the national tournament, a lot of international flavor, different eligibility rules from the NCAA to the NAIA, so more of those international kids have better opportunities to compete in men's soccer or women's soccer or any international athlete for that matter. So you're going to see some tongue-tied twisters there. We'll do the best we can to differentiate between these two teams here, but we're looking forward to this contest. I think you're going to see Grandview come out and be very aggressive in this contest. They're going to somewhat take the national championship. They're not going to be handed it to them. They're not going to let people roll over and just – Grandview, you got that one right next to your name, so we'll just go ahead and give you this one, the next one, and the rest of the week. I expect Grandview to come out and earn this victory. I expect Martin Methodist to play tooth and nail with them here today. So you only hope Martin Methodist plays their best effort, because if they do, they can compete. But if for some reason they fall back on their heels, make some mental mistakes, it could get out of hand quickly.
Yeah, and as we get ready to get going, Martin Methodist will be the away team on the scoreboard, and Grandview will be the home team as they are the higher seed. That's how it works for every game. Higher seed is considered home. And we'll get underway here with the kickoff. And that'll be McLevy about to tap it to Machizu, and we get underway. That's Grandview with the ball. They'll be in the white jerseys, and Martin Methodist will be in the black. And both these teams favor white and black and red style, so similar colors on display here.
Two of the more unique mascots we'll see also, the Red Hawks and the Vikings. There's not too many of those floating around here in Montgomery.
Yeah.
There's some War Hawks and some War Eagles around these parts, but not too many Red Hawks.
Yeah, a lot of Eagles. Eagles usually being a common name. Vikings, not so much. As Martin Methodist gets it here. That's Sean Dong on the sideline. Some nice footwork. And a nice flowing name there.
If I had my John Madden pen, I'd circle number 10 for sure for the Martin Methodist squad. Sean Dong, 11 goals scored on the season, leads the team with 25 points as well. I tell you what my favorite stat is amongst soccer is game-winning goals. He has zero game-winning goals.
Oh, wow.
Excellent goal scorer that he is. He's almost looking for that clutch gene here. So you take a skilled, talented player like Dong and put him in the clutch, the highest, the biggest stage, watch him rise to the occasion.
And Stephen Lunny, the keeper from Dublin, Ireland, picking that one up, and he'll play it forward. Martin Methodist looking to get the ball here, and again, Sean Dong with the ball, and he'll play it wide to Daniel Dunleavy coming down the line. He gets a cross in. Oh, and that one had a chance. It kind of hung up there on the back post, and looks like the keeper did get a touch. That was Eric Hundevad, and got his fingertips on it, so...
Good ball there by Dunleavy. Not a bad idea. High ball away from the goalkeeper. Let's see what his range looks like here early in this contest. They end up getting a corner kick out of it.
And swinging this one in will be Felix Kristoffersen from Sweden. Again, as we mentioned before, a lot of international players from different countries on both these teams. Swung into the box and cleared away here by Grandview. Send into the box, but now it's knocked down. Oh, and the goalkeeper and defender got mixed up there and almost took out his own man. Hundevad coming out, but center back was too quick clearing that one away. Grandview now looking to settle down and possess it. Just keeping possession. Getting it to Ross Galbraith. He'll play it forward. And tracking onto it is Johnny McAdam. And that one goes just wide. It's going to be a goal kick for Martin Methodist.
First real threat we see there from Grandview. They're going to be quick on the outside, strong in the middle. Your tactical pace the ball forward, play out to the wings. They're going to be very textbook in that regard. Strong down the middle, speed on the outside, and that's what we're going to look for. Try to get to that end line, play a ball across the face of the goal, and looking for somebody there on the back door. Just simply nobody there on the back door in that effort.
Yeah, and that number nine, Johnny McAdam, is the leading goal scorer for the Grandview Vikings. He has 12 on the year, and he's always a threat up front, and he was almost on the end of that one.
And McAdam, you said that 12 goals leads the team, 5 game-winning goals
there you go.
On the season. That's my type of guy right there.
So has the ability to win games for his team as we get, I believe that was an offsides call. And Martin Methodist will play it forward here. Martin Methodist, again, as I mentioned, in those black jerseys, the gold numbers, which is a nice touch. And then Grandview in the white with the red numbers as Hundavad, the keeper, collects it for Grandview.
Obviously, having been done with the opening round, 32 teams what we started with here at the national tournament. Now at the national championship, only 16 teams. And so some of these numbers will start to match up what most people will see similar to tournament brackets with the, you know, one playing 16 and 5 and 12. You'll see some of those common numbers here as we move forward. But I tell you what's interesting. There's just a big difference between the RPI, which is what is seed here at the national tournament, and the coaches poll. So all year long, these coaches have voted on these teams. Who's the best team? Top 10, top 25, et cetera. National Raiders, there's many people that get involved. And this Grandview team has been ranked the most number of weeks at number one. Coincidentally so. This year, more teams have been ranked at number one than any previous year. So, yes, we have perhaps the top 16 teams here at the national championship, but I think for the first time in quite some time, there's no real top team. Normally, it's been the Lindsey Wilsons of the world that are just a head and shoulders above everybody else. Not the case here this year. The Ashford team that played earlier here today, a very much excellent shot to win a national championship. Grandview the same way as well. I mean, Lindsey Wilson, can't count them out. Rio Grande, can't count them out. So, yeah, we're going to get to what looks to be a nice little pretty bracket moving forward here, but look for some of the numbers to not mean so much because the skills of these teams are going to be very evenly matched as we move forward this week.
Yeah, and as you mentioned, Lindsey Wilson, they actually lost in their conference play, but they got an at-large bid to get into the tournament and are still the number two seed.
And that's a common theme this year. Some of the top teams lost in their conference tournament, swallowed some of those at-large bids. Mm-hmm. I think Embry-Riddle was the last team to get an at-large bid, and they were ranked somewhere 12, 13 or so. There's only 9 at-large bids handed out, so in the coaches' poll, when you use those at-large bids, the at-large bids ran out of number 13 this year? That's unheard of.
Yeah, and it's just very interesting to see how even these teams have become. And in almost every conference in the NAIA, there's a lot of parity between these teams. Martin Methodist looks to play the corner in now into the box. Oh, and that one's going to give him trouble, but it's cleared off of the line. There are a lot of white jerseys behind that one.
And that ball was definitely hitting the wrong direction there for Grandview, as I believe. It was McLeavy. They got a touch on it, but luckily a teammate there was knocking out of danger.
And that one's played forward in the direction of Brian Lee, one of the players from Scotland. They've got a lot of players from Scotland on this roster. In fact, their entire midfield seems to be made up of Scottish players.
A lot of that depends on the whatever relationship the head coach has with the academies or a certain recruiter overseas, that they kind of come from the same area. It'd be like recruiting from lower Alabama and the panhandle of Florida and South Georgia. Geographically, it fits the same way in Europe as well. It may not be the exact same country, but it's definitely the same lay of the land, depending on who you know and who you get in touch with.
Played back here. Now played forward to McAdam. He's got it. He's the danger man for Grandview. He's getting forward, gets it wide to Ryan McGowan. He gets down the line. Oh, and puts one in. That one just passed the back post. And that one could not make its mind up. It was whether it was a shot or maybe a low cross in for somebody, but it did deflect. It'll be a corner.
Love the move there by McCown. He was actually going for a shot on the back post, but it got the bottom of somebody's cleat and just missed the post.
And Aaron Scott will take the corner for Grandview. Try and swing one into the box here. Brian Lee coming short, but they don't use him. Now cleared away.
Take two on the corner kick here. Grandview had two guys short. Trying to use it again. Just see if the Martin Methodist will tip their hand.
And Brian Lee plays that one in. Oh, and now a shot from outside, and that one's blocked out. Grandview recovers, though. That's Nasamiento getting down the line, the outside back, and he'll win another corner. Grandview, whew, dangerous opportunities.
D'Souza with a phenomenal left foot there on the volley. Doesn't let it touch the ground. Most volleys come from the ground up. This one came from the sun, from the sky, fall from the heavens, and just had a deflection by a black shirt, or else you're looking at a glorious first goal.
Yeah, the big old center mid got forward there, timed that one well, and oh, good thing Martin Methodist was in front of that goal. This one will be swung in to the back post. A little too far, and Grandview tries to possess it. Sean Dong coming back, though, and he'll just kick it forward so Martin Methodist can regroup. On the far side, that's Aaron Scott to take the throw.
Grandview's going to tighten up their cleats here for sure. Really like their first effort, and they're going to come at the second, third, and fourth effort here rather quickly here, trying to tilt that field in one direction and play downhill.
Grandview looking to possess there. Oh, and a little throw off the back. Smart play there by Nasamiento. Threw it off the back of his own player to just get it to his own feet and get it in play. Now played forward. Not out of bounds. Some players calling for it. And coming onto it is Brian Lee. He'll touch it down for D'Souza. Outside. Nice move. And that's Andrew McLevy down the line.
Love the footwork there by Grandview, trying to get in, trying to get out. Too long of a touch to the outside there, but really setting up his defenders, kind of like in basketball. You cross over, maybe go hard to the right the first time, then cross back over to the left the second time. He's setting up that right back there for Martin Methodist, knowing he's going to have more opportunities in the game.
And now a player down for Martin Methodist. It looked like one of their center backs. We'll see if we can get you his number, but he is facing away from us.
Have been watched soccer all year long, NAIA level, NCAA level, whatever the case may be. There's been an emphasis put on this year with officials in keeping the game moving. If a player is down, for whatever reason, flop, injured, drawing a call, whatever the case may be, officials have been great this year as a point of emphasis to address the player. Are you hurt? Do you need attention? If you do not, get up and let's move on.
Yeah.
Sometimes, rightfully so, you get the wind knocked out, even though the case may be.
Mm-hmm.
You just need a moment, which is perfectly understandable given the circumstances. But obviously, receiving that medical attention, you're going to have to step off the field here in this situation. So you're going to see that carry on all week long. And again, it's not being rude about it. He's just simply referee's trying to do his job and keep the game moving along here. And so clearly the Red Hawk that is down needed to receive some sort of attention here. And this is obviously not good with one of your best players at center back being down for the count here.
Yeah, and Griff Sims is the head referee for this game. He's walking over there, checking things out. And we saw in the first game one of the Ashford players go down with a head injury, and they actually moved him off the field, had to bring him back on. So see if that's the case or if he can continue.
And Josh, good call with your choice of words there. Head injury, much different than concussions, because in mm-hmm. soccer you can catch an elbow, you can catch a scrape, whatever the case may be, and it's not like the American football where they assume head injuries mean concussions. So
yep.
Anytime you hear that word concussions, trainers, doctors, team physicians are going to be ultra cautious in their prognosis moving forward there. So luckily this isn't of any of those varieties. Seemed to be a right leg injury, as he'll step off here and probably be allowed to step back on rather quickly here.
And the goalkeeper for Martin Methodist, Stephen Lunny, will kick it forward. And he is a Capital One Academic All-American this year.
Means he's smart, right?
Yeah.
Okay, just checking.
Smarter than us, I think.
Absolutely.
And now coming down the line is the right back. That's Daniel Dunleavy from Dublin, Ireland. much like his keeper, Stephen Lunny. And interesting to see Martin Methodist pushing that right back up a lot, giving cover with the center backs and the left back staying back, but it'll be interesting to see how he gets forward.
Yeah, that center back there is Christian Keen Owens there that stepped off. He has not stepped back on here, and so Martin Methodist has gone with a full sub here to get into the game to assist with the man down.
Now the center backs for them are number 18, Shane Powell, and number 19, Nick Durbin.
Yeah, Durbin steps on. Talk about being thrown in the fire here. The freshman is stepping on for another freshman here. So should be interesting. Maybe perhaps Graham Duke could take advantage of that youthfulness and perhaps inexperience there on the coming off the bench. Durbin started in 8 games so far this year. He's coming off the bench in 16 of them, but no goals, no assists registered to his name.
Now played forward. Grandview gets that one pulled out of the box. There's a good cross in the box. Sean Dong again on the line, squared it back to his right back, Dunleavy. He put one in there, but Grandview now slowing things down. D'Souza, the playmaker out of that defensive mid position. Now he plays it forward to McAdam. Now wide to Lee. Back to McAdam, and now just kind of settle things down. Grandview with some nice possession here. McAdam holds it. And now all the way back to their center backs, and they'll just keep looking, keep prodding, trying to find that opening. D'Souza again to his center back, Ross Alexander, who plays forward. Now Martin Methodist gets it away.
That's what Martin Methodist is not going to have to do there. When the ball's in the back line there, just can't clear it forward. Grandview's going to win that ball. It's going to be a hard press for Martin Methodist to just win those 50-50 balls into space there around midfield. They've got to literally possess thing, build the attack all the way from the back. So another prime example, yep. Back-to-back. Just can't boot it forward and have no intentful purpose on that pass. Must have a target, must have a jersey, and it must get there.
I believe that was Durbin on the clearance who just subbed in, and like you were saying, the freshman clearing it forward to nobody.
Because what's going to happen is you're going to kick that ball away. Grammy's going to win it. They're going to come right back down your throat. They're just going to keep punching and punching and punching, and eventually they're going to knock one home.
Now getting it forward. That was Fulton with the layoff. Now coming on the wing. Oh, a good ball in, and Sean Dong was in the area.
Dong was there for sure.
Now goalkeeper coming out, and he'll just clear that one in the stands. Better be safe than sorry.
Yeah, really came off his end line there, outside the mouth of the goal, wide of his penalty area, and just had the angle to clear that into the bleachers. It's an interesting sequence. Definitely weird. I don't think I would want my goalie that far out this early in the game.
Yeah, and if he does come that far out, you better make sure you clear it as far as he did, or else you could have some trouble on your hands. But Hoendevad, the goalie, senior, he's experienced. Maybe they give him a little more license to come off his line than most. Now thrown in by Dunleavy. He gets it back from Dong. Now swung into the box, but headed away by Grandview. Still, Martin Methodist putting in some good crosses here. Oh, nice cutback. That was Jonathan Redmond, and he puts one in. But again, Grandview somehow scrambles it away.
Grandview with excellent spacing defensively. I know that sounds really silly, but when the ball is put into the box, they're not on top of each other. They're not bunched up. They understand their responsibilities that I've got the near post, I've got the penalty area, the elbow at the six, whatever the case may be, whatever the scheme is defensively for the Vikings, they definitely understand the spacing that they're supposed to have, and that's why you see a lot of those one-touch clearance, whether it be the head, the touch, whatever. There's not a lot of traffic in there. It's good coaching.
Yeah, and the two center backs, Ross Alexander and David Machizu, are very strong back there. Keep them organized, and you've got to be able to lead by talking to your other defenders as well. Now played over to the right side, but just straight into the hands of Stephen Lunny. And Grandview did a good job of switching the field there, but just couldn't find the feet. That was Ryan McGowan who was trying to swing that one wide. Now here with it is Jonathan Redmond again. Oh, and he puts one in, and that's another dangerous cross by Martin Methodist.
As much as I want to compliment Grandview's defense and their spacing, Dong has weaved his way through there more than once and has been on the right side of those crosses. I don't mean right versus left. I mean right versus wrong. He's able to finagle his way in there. They're able to target him. He just can't get quite everything square, shoulder square, feet square, hip square. I haven't been able to put that finishing touch, but he's been a threat in that box.
Grandview will play it forward. That's the keeper, Hundevad, to McAdam. Oh, and crowded out of that one was Andrew McLevy. And we would like to thank Select Sport America. Select is both a broadcast sponsor of this year's national championships, also the official soccer ball of NAIA soccer. As Grandview gets this one, they're using that Select soccer ball out there, and it's already got us 5 goals today.
Definitely getting us working for sure.
Martin Methodist wins it back. That's Hill. Or Redmond, my fault. He pulls it back. Now back to the back line. Swung over to Dunleavy. He plays it forward. It gets through to Dong. And cleared out of bounds off a Grandview player. That's Ross Galbraith trying to make a play on it. Dunleavy will look to find feet, and he does. And it's played forward, but now D'Souza corrals it, and Grandview will look to control it. And Grandview playing it around the back, but kind of dangerously, ball popping up a lot.
To you and I, that's dangerous. To them, it's practice. I mean, it puts fans on the edge of their seats, but they're just so cool, calm, and collective here is what I've already noticed in the first 15 to 20 minutes, and nothing seems to faze them, even a goalkeeper running outside the box and clearing the ball away. That back line inside the penalty area, possessing things out of the back, it's beautiful.
And a great overlap by McLevy, and he puts one in there. And he'll go out of bounds for a throw-in, not getting over that end line.
If you didn't know any better, you thought Grandview came out here and played flat. They seem very no emotions. They seem very very lethargic almost, but this is how they play the game. They're very prepared for this game. They're going to be very methodical, and they understand today's not the national championship game. Saturday is, and that's where their sights are set. It's going to be a long week.
Yeah, and they look ready to play. It does look like kind of a practice match out there for them. They're taking their time on the ball, passing, and not making any dangerous passes either. They're playing to feet. So this one's played forward. That's to Fulton. Fulton pulls back. Finds Redmond, who's been down that line a lot for the Redhawks. Now he's got to pull it back, though. Good D by the Vikings. Now swung in, looking for the head of Fulton. Now Grandview gets it back, and they'll get a throw. McGowan just plays it back to the center backs, and now to D'Souza, who's definitely kind of like the pendulum of the defense and the defensive possession. He keeps moving, moves it back and forth, swings the field, and comes to get the ball, and he wants it on his foot to get it forward. And he does get it again here. Played forward here, down the line. And that was Brian Lee trying to get to it, but just a little out of his reach. Martin Methodist now coming the other way. Ooh, and a nice touch there. That's Redmond once again. And he's been beating those defenders and getting crosses off. And a nice move. Teixeira plays it forward to Dong. Dong down the end line. Oh, and just out of bounds. It'll be a corner kick, though.
Nice job there by Dong. He knew it. He just shaved off the top of the head of the Redhawks, or excuse me, of the Vikings defender. So instead of perhaps fumbling out of bounds, just simply rolled off the inline and gets the team a corner kick.
And to play it in will be number 8 Redmond, who's been on that left wing, and he'll swing it in with his left foot. In swing and corner. That one's into the box dangerously, but cleared away by Grandview. Now Durbin clears it forward, puts it back into the box. Oh, and a lot going on in there. And a man's down in the back. That's Nosamiento.
He's going to be down here. This is no hesitation here at all. He literally took a clearance from about 5 feet away off the dome. He's going to be down for the count here, and he's going to need some help either from a teammate or from a trainer just to physically stand up here. He took a quick shot to the face. This is not going to be kind.
And Grandview was just trying to clear that one away, and he was in the line of fire, and that's never good to take a ball to the face like that. And that is Nosamiento. Trying to get it correct, I was calling him Nosamiento.
So he is going to step off and probably would have volunteered for it here just to get his bearings and get focused back in. Vision a little blurry, I'm assuming. So he'll step back on here. First 20 minutes, three corner kicks for EC squad. No quote shots on goal just yet here, but both these teams firing at will for sure.
Yeah, neither one of these teams getting too much from the run of play yet. But we'll see if the methodical possession of Grandview can result in anything for them. Martin Methodist getting down the wings well and attacking from them. Redman and Sean Dong, definitely the driving forces of the attack for this team. Now it'll be played back as Martin Methodist stopped it. Fair play there, and Grandview will give it back to them for the injured player.
Sportsmanship presides overall here. Definitely great job there by Grandview. Just simply resets the possession, drops it all the way back to Martin Methodist. Martin Methodist is going to continue play, and the referee will allow the injured player to step back on the field rather quickly here. So great job, all parties included, getting that sorted out.
Now coming forward is McLevy. He's got it matched up against the outside back, but Martin Methodist again, the defense looking strong. And now coming from an offside position was number 9, Michael Fulton, the 6'4 freshman from Scotland.
I was going to say, Fulton can't hide, literally there. 6'4 out there. If you're a step or two or 10 offsides, everybody in the park's going to know it.
Oh, and a hard tackle there and a shot from McLevy. And now Hill's got it. Lee, my fault, has it on the left side. Oh, and another man down. And, yeah, he took that shot.
Yeah, this is a defender came sliding in there with a good tackle there. And I believe after the ball was cleared out, he did his job, so to speak. But you can see the player for Grandview. I think that's number 16, if I'm not mistaken there. That's McLevy that had the shot. He collided with the defender for the Redhawks. Both are literally down here, but I'm not so sure. Perhaps number 7, I think, if I'm not mistaken there. Josh, if you can help me out, is down inside the box. And he took the brunt end of the collision.
Yeah, it may be. I believe that's number 2, Daniel Dunleavy, who took the shot. Yeah, the right back for Martin Methodist, and already two kind of bad shots like that.
Three players have had to step off this field for medical attention so far here. And even despite a shot to the face earlier, I believe Dunleavy might have taken the worst blow so far.
Now Martin Methodist will get it and just clear it back to the Grandview center backs, and again, some good sportsmanship from them.
Absolutely.
Center backs possessing that ball, and this is what we've seen from Grandview so far, just methodical possession, smart passes, and just playing the ball around. Nosamiento, who took that blow at right back, he'll play it back now. And swung around. Aaron Scott controlling. Overlap by D'Souza. And now Lee sprays the pass away. Martin Methodist with a strong defense. They collapse in as soon as Grandview gets it forward. They're fine with them playing in front of the forwards and midfielders, but once it gets in to Martin Methodist's defensive third, they collapse on it. Now played forward. Here's Lee. Tries to get down the line, but Dunleavy with a good tackle, and he's the one who just went down from that injury.
Mm-hmm. Good sight to see for sure.
Now played forward. That's Machizu winning that ball back for Grandview, and it's forward now, and McGowan getting down that line. He's got some pace. Oh, but the Methodist defenders crowd him out. The Redhawks with some stifling defense.
Yeah, great job there by both the left back and the left center back there. Sandwiched in the defense, I believe that was Powell and Madrigal, just both the closed the elevator doors, and great job defensively there to keep the goose egg on the scoreboard.
Now coming the other way, Sean Dong again getting down the line, taking his man on, and he'll win. I believe it's just a throw. Yeah, throw on the sideline. And he's matched up against Ross Galbraith. And Galbraith will have his hands full today.
Very seldomly do you watch any sort of competition, and there's one player that jumps off the page on you. And right now, to me, it's Sean Dong from Martin Methodist here. I don't know if he's the best player on the field, but for the first 25 minutes that I haven't seen him play the game, he grabs my attention. He is 0 to 60 in about 1.5 steps, and that's with the soccer ball at his feet.
Mm-hmm.
So a give and a go is where he is going to live and die here. It's at least where he can excel at for sure, and Martin Methodist is going to have to find him and honestly get him some more touches here in this contest.
Yeah, close control at speed is what you look for. An attacking wing player like that, you think of players like Lionel Messi or Cristiano Ronaldo. It's very fast, but they keep the ball on their foot the entire time. Sean Dong is one of those special players. Now played forward, Galbraith gets it back. And Martin Methodist again, once again, crowding the ball out and just winning it back.
And again, if you understand what we're talking about with Dong, you have to know where he's at all times. You can't lose sight of him, because if you're not touching him, if you're not keeping him between your line of sight and the ball, or you're not touching him, you don't feel him, he's going to be gone. By the time you think, he's gone, and it's already a goal.
And if they can get a ball through to him at all and he gets past that back line, it's over. And now out of bounds, it'll be Martin Methodist throw. Join the 60,000 student-athletes who participate in sports at the NAIA, where there are 23 national championships and student-athletes earn more than $450 million in scholarships each year. Learn more about opportunities to play in the NAIA at NAIA.org.
What was that number?
It was
$450 million?
Yeah, $450 million in scholarships.
Sounds like a good payday to me.
Oh, played here in the box. Yeah, NAIA schools have scholarship money to give out. And as a former soccer player in the NAIA who wasn't fantastic, I did get a little bit of a scholarship. So if I can, well, pretty much anyone can.
Fair enough.
Now played forward, McAdam. Gets it to D'Souza again. Again, he's the one controlling the play for Grandview, just checking to the ball wherever it is. Defensive midfield player. And again, he gets it. Played wide. McLevy now hands it back to Galbraith. Around to McAdam. McAdam's been dropping deeper and deeper to get that ball. He's there. Best attacking player from what the stats say, and he's trying to get the ball. And now, on the sideline, played in. McAdam has it, but he's got no room to turn. Martin Methodist still here. Ball still in there, but finally cleared away. Sean Dong will get down the sideline, but he can't quite save it.
Both coaches are going to go to the bench here for Grandview. They're going to get two subs, two fresh legs under the game, one for Martin Methodist here. Both these, all these players, I should say, who step off the field won't be allowed to re-enter here in the rest of the first half. So Dong, one of the guys stepping off, he'll get an extended halftime period here. Second half, sub all day long, in and out, whatever the case may be. Find you a matchup, but resting those legs for Dong for a stretch run in the second half.
Mm-hmm. Kenneth Monhey coming on for him, number 11 there on the left wing. Grandview gets it forward, and the Grandview subs were Matthew Kenton, number 10, and Paul Reeshus, my fault, from Holland. And now Martin Methodist gets it. It's Teixeira playing that center midfield role, drifting out here a little bit. They get it to Monhay, who gets it down to Fulton. Fulton tries to get one in, but it'll be off the defender and out for a throw. And to take it will be number two, Daniel Dunleavy, who's done a great job of getting down that end line and overlapping his wing player. Now thrown in and deflected off of Grandview. Another corner kick here for Martin Methodist. We've had seven already.
Obviously, if you're the lower seed, underdog, whatever the case may be, the longer this game goes scoreless or even to halftime, you gain more confidence. And what would it do for this Red Hawk squad to capitalize on one of these corner kicks, especially in the first half?
Jonathan Raymond. He is from France, so although it appears Raymond, it is Raymond.
I'll take your word for it.
Played into the box, but a little too far over here. And now getting it is the newly checked in Dutch forward. That's Paul Rieshuis. Gets it back here from his winger. And taken down.
Good takedown there by Martin Methodist. They know they want to just stop the counterattack. Let's get the man or the ball there in that situation and just get reset and everybody get everybody behind the ball.
And D'Souza to take the free kick. Souza assesses his options here. Grandview getting a lot of bodies into the box, including their center back, Ross Alexander. Souza stands over it. And now swung in there. Long ball, but it'll be collected by Stephen Lunny.
Souza's going to want that one back there. That one curled toward the near post. I think he wanted to start that one more toward the outside of the goal and peel it back toward the back post there for a header. But he'll make the adjustment for sure.
And Lunny boots that one forward to Souza. And Romero going up and challenging for that one. Now Raymond down the line for Fulton. Back to Raymond, and now they reset to the center backs. Powell gets it out to Dunleavy, who plays another one in, this time early. Romero. Oh, and a long shot there. And that one had a chance. That was Raymond again.
Raymond with a hint of optimism there. Nice little bouncing left foot for the line drive over the top of the crossbar. But I think most importantly here for Martin Methodist, 2, 3, 4, 5 passes in a row get you at least a shot on goal. That's the best sequence they have had so far here in the first half. Passes that have a purpose to your teammates' feet.
Yeah, and Raymond kind of popped that one up for himself. He flicked it up and then decided to hit the volley. He's got a bit of skill. We've seen it already. And in the end, Hunavad didn't have too much to worry about. As Matthew Kenton gets the ball here, he's the new substitution. He comes forward onto it again. Oh, and this pass sprayed away. Once again, Stephen Lunny will collect. We would like to thank Bonefish Grill, a broadcast partner of this year's event. At Bonefish Grill, enjoy our signature appetizer, Bang Bang Shrimp. Toss in a creamy Asian-inspired sauce with a kick. Bonefish Grill, located at the Shops at East Chase, right here in Montgomery. And here once again, getting mixed up a little bit in midfield as McAdam comes onto it. He'll get it wide. And now swung into the box. That's Lee coming onto it. Oh, and a shot! This one blocked once again by Martin Methodist. That was Teixeira getting in the way of it, and he plays it forward.
Martin Methodist did a good job. They've knocked down a couple of shots so far by Grandview, not letting it get to their goalkeeper. And Teixeira adds another one there, just simply standing in front of the shot taker and deflects it away.
Played forward, Kenton trying to get there, but he's beat out by Dunleavy. Played forward in the direction of Michael Fulton, but he wasn't there. Now played wide to Nascimento, who took that shot earlier back on the field. Good to see him. He's got the bright pink wristbands on today. Now played into McAdam once again, and he gets it wide, and this is where they can be dangerous. That's McGowan on the right side. And back to McAdam, who's controlling the play up top.
Again, Martin Method just denies the pass.
D'Souza trying to make a run in. Finds McAdam now wide to Lee. And a good tackle again by Martin Methodist. That's staunch defense by them.
Sort of a bend but don't break defense right now by Martin Methodist. Grandview obviously controlling possession. They've been able to move the ball forward. They've gotten crosses. They've gotten headers. They've gotten shots. But nothing on goal.
Yeah, and definitely have read the scouting report for Grandview and know exactly what they're up against. They know that Grandview wants to possess. But again, look where all the players on the field are. Behind that half-field stripe, the only player very far forward is Fulton, the forward, and everyone else behind the ball.
Martin Meth is very good at this, too. 8 shutouts on the season. They only give up 75 shots on goal all season. So not just the 61 saves there for Lundy is definitely a credit to his testament, but that defense more probably gets credit with 8 shutouts on the season and only giving up 75 shots on goal. I mean, we may have to ask Lundy what that math is in terms of shots on goal per game, but you get my point here. You played 20-something games a season so far and only giving up 75 shots on goal. You're looking at 2, 3, most sometimes 4 shots on goal, so that's only 4 saves a game at most that Lundy has to come up with.
Yeah, and Lunny has done well so far. He hasn't been tested too often. Just had to pick up a few and get a cross or two. Checking in for Grandview was number 24, Austin Kelly. He's a senior midfielder. And now getting forward is Monhay. Owen cleared away there, but back to Martin Methodist feet. Monhay, some nice skill. But Owen Kelly gets tripped as he comes onto the field, and he'll draw a foul.
Too many white shirts in the back half there for Grandview. You can dribble and beat one. You can dribble and maybe get lucky and beat two. But that third and fourth defender, you're going to have to do it with the pass. Get out in open space, whatever the case may be. It's not going to be able to be a one-man show.
And as you were mentioning before with Martin Methodist, 8 shutouts this year. That's good for 14th in Division I in NAIA.
Yeah, that's not too bad.
Yeah, not too shabby. D'Souza now with the ball and swung around. Once again, Grandview just possessing. Kelly with a nice layoff, and he'll get it back. Owen now played forward. Oh, and a tough shot there. That's Lunny going down, and running onto it was Paul Rieshoofs. And the Dutch forward looked like he came through on that one and just...
I'm not sure who Lunny hit. He might have hit his own guy, because his own guy was shielding off the attacker. And when Lunny went down to go pick it up, he might have been ran through by his own guy. I'm not sure.
Yeah, and Kelly played that ball through. And when you've got a forward running in at you, can be a lot of collisions. Lunny brave to go down for that ball and looks like he's okay and will continue on, which is good to see.
Yeah, I think technically you would want your keeper to slide in and protect that ball, not just bend over at the waist and really expose yourself. You want to protect yourself, protect your body when trying to protect that ball.
Lunny plays it forward after that collision. Monhay with the back heel, but nothing there. And now McAdam again. Once again controlling that tempo. He and D'Souza playing a lot of passes around.
It's my favorite time of a ball game right here, Josh, is minutes to go before halftime. One team is trying to get the halftime. The other team is trying to score before halftime. It's you can really steal the halftime locker room, because if you're in the first half right now, coaches are saying the exact same thing. Guys, you're doing a great job. Keep up the energy. Yeah. Keep up the effort. Here's what we can do differently. But with one goal, which you're only halfway through this contest, it's nothing to fret about. With one goal, one locker room becomes, hey, great job. Keep up the energy. Here's what we're doing right. The other locker room that's down a goal starts, it's now a negative conversation. What are you doing? Why are you doing this? Mm-hmm. This is where you screwed up. This is where we've got to do better. You can really steal the halftime locker room. And with 18, 19, 20-year-old kids, that can affect you the next 10 to 15 minutes bleeding over into the second half. So this is a big, big 8 minutes or so right here to try to steal that halftime locker room.
Yeah, and played forward here. Oh, and a dangerous header backwards. Fulton tracking onto it. And that one will go out of bounds for a corner. It looked like Hundevad mishandled that one, and this could be a dangerous opportunity for Martin Methodist.
I'm not sure what Michael Fulton's major is at Martin Methodist, but if he's not in drama or in acting, he can definitely make himself for an official here, because he was standing right on top of that, called for the flag, got it on his forehead. Maybe politics in the future for Fulton, I'm not sure, but he gets the call.
And now to be played in by Martin Methodist. Trying to see who that is over on the far side. He has bright shoes. Now played in there. Grandview gets it away. Raymond. Down the line. Played in here. Oh, and a header, and it's a goal. Martin Methodist with an absolutely fantastic cross in. And that one's going to be 1-0 Red Hawks.
Romero leaks his way into the penalty area. Grandview has a breakdown. Nobody picked up the man to the right side there on the through ball. Header fantastically finished. Nobody home there inside the six-yard box. Keeper never had a chance, and that's a phenomenal finish, I believe, by Romero, his fourth of the season.
Yep, that did look like Romero on the finish. And then the cross, beautifully set up, was Kenneth Monet, who checked on earlier in the half. He wasn't a starter. Great cross, straight to the head, and finished off well by Nicholas Romero.
Monet with a great assist there. Just found his man, delivered the ball right where it needed to be. Nothing too fancy with it. Just a right foot to the target and just a great setup. He also got lost that penalty area, scored it out to the right of the box, and just beautiful delivery there. And all of a sudden, Martin Methodist starts to believe here in the first half.
And Grandview trying to get their feet back under them after they get knocked off them from that goal. And again, just a beautiful cross set up by Monhay. Now cleared away. Getting there is Christofferson. He plays it wide to Raymond.
Perhaps Grandview trending in the wrong direction here. They have only given up 18 goals all season long, and now they have given up 7 goals in the last 4 games.
Interesting when they get into conference play and the tournament. It's always good to be better than you were at the beginning of the year and maybe starting to go in the wrong direction.
Hasn't fazed Grandview too much. They've won 12 games in a row, but it seems as they've had some breakdowns defensively over the last couple games. But they've been pretty good at outscoring opponents there. Those are 7 goals they've given up here, Josh. They've won 7-1, 3-2, and 4-3. So giving up goals all day long is okay as long as you're outscoring your opponents. We need to see that here for the Vikings in the second half or maybe the next 50 minutes.
Yeah, now that you've seen what they try and do and what Martin Methodist does, you see that Martin Methodist has locked down very well on what Grandview is trying to do, which is possess and then get forward. Martin Methodist putting a lot of guys back. And now that they've got the goal, they'll look to do that even more, I would think. Monhay gets it. On the sideline, plays it to Dunleavy. Oh, and he gets taken out by Matthew Kenton.
Kenton just late to the party there. He knew it too. He was going for that ball. It was a 50-50 ball. He went in hard, went in low, cleats down, toe down. That's perfectly fine. Just a hair late, and he'll get called for the foul.
The NAIA Champions of Character program helps student-athletes understand and embody what character truly means. It also provides student-athletes, coaches, and parents the training to know, do, and value the right thing, both inside and outside of sports. Learn more about the NAIA's programs to promote character at NAIA.org. Swung in here by Raymond. Oh, and another dangerous ball. This one cleared away by D'Souza. It'll be called either offside or a foul in the box.
Yeah, flag up to the near side. Not exactly sure. There's no way where that ball is going to be placed that it was offside, so perhaps a foul with some elbowing going on inside the box, but the linesman seemed to have a good eye of view, and so he'll point in the direction of Grandview.
And Grandview will look to get some momentum back before the end of this first half.
It's only Grandview's 12-game winning streak in this entire tournament that it's overshadowed by Martin Methodist's 9-game winning streak, so you could say probably the two hottest teams here at the tournament are playing here in the first round. Round of 16 here for the national championship. First round was last weekend is my point, but of the teams here at the final site, these are probably the two hottest teams coming into the contest.
And both teams have shown that they want to fight for it. And a lot of hand fighting in there, pulling and grabbing by both players, but nothing called. Monhay coming away with the ball, but now Grandview gets possession again. And a challenge from behind, and this one will be called. And that's Nick Durbin, the freshman, on the foul.
Yeah, I can't disagree with this call here. Going through the defender was Durbin, the defender, going through the attacker for Grandview there. Did get the ball. Man did go down. Just can't go through him from behind like that. And so Grandview with a prime opportunity here right before halftime.
McAdam will swing it in, the leading goal scorer from Scotland. Oh, and D'Souza gets up well, but didn't get enough power on that one. Bounced just wide. And again, D'Souza playing that center defensive mid role. He's a 6'1 senior from Sao Paulo, Brazil, and he and the other center mids have controlled the tempo, but unfortunately haven't been able to get any much of anything in the attacking third. About 2 minutes left here, 2:10 to be exact, as Martin Methodist looks to ride this momentum into halftime. Played forward by Lunny. Oh, and now this one forward and chasing onto it is Gideon Peterson, who checked in recently. I forgot to call his name. He checked in for Fulton. Now getting forward is Reese Hoos. Oh, he plays one in. McAdam's in the area, and it's knocked around in there, and then offsides will be Reese Hoos.
Late call there. I think that ball went over the end line there. It should be a goal kick for Martin Methodist. No, I think you're right, Josh. I'll shut up and sit down. That was an offside call.
That was an interesting one because I think the deflection and Reese Hoos was kind of in the area is why they called it. Lunny will take it and kick it forward. McAdam getting a nice opportunity there, though. He was in the right position. Now played forward. This one just cleared towards the newly checked in Gideon Peterson. But Grandview will win it back. McGowan gets it taken away from him. Martin Methodist again with some nice work. Ramon tracking back and now playing it to his outside back. And Peterson is offsides. He's from Nigeria, the 5'11 midfielder. He's listed as midfielder, but he's playing that target forward role for Martin Methodist. Now played forward. Vikings try and settle it down, and now they do. D'Souza tries to take it past, but a nice takeaway by Christofferson. Heel flick. Raymond has it again. Played to Monhey. We don't have much time left here, and they'll let it run out. That is the half, and Martin Methodist with what some would consider the stunning 1-0 lead going into halftime.
Yeah, absolutely. Stunning is a word you could use here for Grandview. I don't think they're going to hit the panic button by any means. Longtime veteran coach and Blair Reed's been there, gosh, 20-something years, maybe even 30. That wouldn't surprise me there. Tons of wind under his belt. This Grandview team is a veteran team, number one team in the country. This is, yes, Martin Methodist may have stolen the halftime locker room. Don't want to take anything away from them, but don't count this Grandview team out here. They've given up some goals here recently. They've scored even more goals than what they've given up here. Not new territory, but definitely somewhat unsettling for sure. If you aren't Methodist, you just keep believing. You just keep cranking. You just keep putting gas in that bus in hopes it gets you to tomorrow.
Yeah, and with that, we'll take it to the break. Again, 1-0 scoreline. Martin Methodist, the 16 seed, leading against Grandview from Iowa. 1-0 scoreline, and we'll take you to the break.
There's a call to be answered. The spirit of competition is still alive inside. The desire still drives. The phrase, student-athlete, has a great ring to it. Lasting friendships are ready to be made. You just want to keep playing. Game on. Get in the game at playnaia.org.
Tra la la tra la tra la
Blender.
Every Italian family has their own treasured recipes. And now at Carrabba's, we're serving up two family favorites on one plate. Like our wood-grilled sirloin, topped with handmade marsala sauce and served alongside our signature chicken Brian ravioli. Or enjoy fresh ingredients and layers of flavor, all grilled over a wood fire with our Polo Rosa Maria and chicken involtini. Some of our best recipes are together at last, but only for a short time. So find your favorite tonight and come home to Carrabba's.
I had a dream, a beautiful dream. I couldn't believe how real it seemed. Up on stage, in a field of green, on the winding river, in a song you'll sing. When I wake up, I'll see you, you in Montgomery, where dreams come true.
The Select Super Elite is the official soccer ball of the NAIA. Select Sport America is the proud sponsor of the NAIA Men's and Women's National Soccer Coach of the Year and Player of the Year Awards. NAIA member schools are provided the opportunity to participate in the Select Sport Ball Adoption Program, where a percentage of all Super Elite sales are donated to the NAIA Champions of Character Program. Please contact your local dealer for more information on the finest hand-sewn soccer balls in the world. Select Sport America, the official soccer ball of the NAIA. Torbo Sports Group, the official video production company of this year's national championship. Don't forget, fans, you can purchase a video download of any game from this year's national championship games with video and audio commentary available. Visit TSG online at www.torbosportsgroup.com. And Bonefish Grill. We would like to thank Bonefish Grill of Montgomery, Alabama. Bonefish Grill is located at the shops of East Chase shopping area. Bonefish Grill has the best holiday gifts available. When you buy $100 gift cards, receive a $20 bonus card. For more information, stop by the Montgomery location or visit them online at www.bonefishgrill.com. And welcome back to the NAIA National Championship. And this one, Martin Methodist facing off against Grandview. Martin Methodist out of Tennessee, Grandview out of Iowa. And this game has been a close one the entire game. First half ended 1-0. Martin Methodist getting a goal in about the last 10 minutes of that half. And a header goal, and they've been defending well all game. So we'll see if Grandview can make a difference in this half.
I want to welcome aboard all the Red Hawks fans that have flipped over from the women's game. Martin Methodist is one of the few soccer programs that has both a men's and women's team at the Final Sight National Championship. And from what we understand, the Martin Methodist women's team down 1-0 at halftime, but the guys on top 1-0. So I'm sure there's some flipping back and forth,
yeah,
some credit card numbers and passwords being exchanged, trying to watch the broadcast here, because I'm sure they were firmly on the women's bandwagon in the first half. And I was like, our guys are beating the number one team in the tournament. Let's flip over and watch that. So welcome everybody aboard here for sure.
Yeah, definitely a good thing for those fans to see their men's team at least doing well to take a lead and hopefully keep it here for the rest of that second half. Head coach of the Red Hawks, Jerry Cleary, actually won two NAIA women's titles in 2005 and 2007.
I believe this is his third year with the Martin Methodist squad and their first appearance in the national tournament. So they had want to make sure they had the happy to be here feeling. Now they have the let's do this thing. Let's do this type attitude since they're already here.
And we'll see if they can hold that lead for the rest of the time. And they have come out determined and have definitely given Grandview more than they would have hoped for in this second round game and final 16 game. Opening round, of course, was held at school sites. This game, the second round, all of these games will be held at this complex. Now Grandview, once again, trying to just keep possession around that box. That's Aaron Scott with a long shot. And that one bounces right in front of Stephen Lunny. And the keeper from Ireland, as well as the Capital One Academic All-American, scoops that one up.
I'm sure Martin Methodist is going to take any advantage they can in this contest. Obviously, holding on to a 1-0 lead is probably not the plan of attack. But nonetheless here, the shadow's starting to get a little bit long here as the sun's going to set behind the corner flag to the right part of your screen. So what's this going to do? It's going to create a lot of problems for Grandview's goalkeeper. And you can see he's trying to adjust to it. Came out here in the second half with a ball cap on, trying to shield that sun. So my point is, what made me think of it, that shot that Grandview just had is going to be quite potent on the left side of the field for Martin Methodist.
Yeah, and another one swung in the box. The goal scorer, Romero, going up for that one, trying to get to it, but cleared away by Grandview. And they get it to McLevy, now out on the left wing. Now back in, and good tackle there. But Grandview keeps possession of it. And McGowan controlling, now plays it back. Tried to find McAdam, but is outside back. Machizu has to get back to it and gives it back to McAdam.
Josh, not to beat a dead horse, but you said Grandview to keep possession. You're going to hear a lot of that here in the second half. They're going to try to do everything they can to put. We saw Martin Methodist have some success with 2, 3, and 4 touches. Grandview's touches are going to be 6, 7, 8, and 9, not necessarily 1, 2, and 3.
Yeah, and they keep possession for a long time. If you were watching the first half, you saw that for the lion's share of that half, they kept possession. Now Sean Dong with a strong shoulder charge. And he'll take down the much bigger Ross Alexander.
Did I mention I like Sean Dong?
You did. And he is quite the player for Martin Methodist. He and Raymond, the wingers for this team. And now Sean Dong actually playing more in a attacking position. He's at that target forward spot. And he played on the right wing in the first half. And slotting in on that right side is Monhey, who actually subbed in the first half. So Martin Methodist going with a little bit of a different look up top. Now played back. McAdam coming forward with it. And he gets it forward. Machizu drops it, crossed into the box, but again cleared away. Now they'll serve another one in there. And Grandview just trying to find an opening at this point. Galbraith once served in there. Oh, and climbing over the back was a Martin Methodist defender. But it'll be called the other way, much to the chagrin of Grandview fans here.
I really wasn't hoping to see this, but I had it somewhat in my notes here. As this game continues to melt away, this clock for Grandview, how is their demeanor? Can they control their emotions? Can they not point the finger? And the telltale sign of that is going to be their body language. When a call doesn't go their way, how do they respond? Does frustration set in for this Viking squad?
Yeah, and speaking of that ball, we would like to thank Select Sport America. Select is both a broadcast sponsor of this year's national championships, also the official soccer ball of the NAIA soccer.
And I believe there's going to be a protest for this ball by every goalkeeper that makes the trip here to Montgomery, because based on my math here, we've got 6 goals in more than 3 periods of soccer here, including an overtime. So that ball needs to be a little bit denser, according to the goalkeepers.
Needs to not move as much in the air as it has.
Needs to be less balloon-like.
Now this one played forward. Oh, and flicked over the top. Sean Dong getting onto the end of it. Oh, and the keeper and defender with a collision here. And Grandview scrambles and gets it away. That was quite the play.
Great sequence there. First by Martin Methodist. Dong makes a perfectly timed run off the flick of the header. Not to be outdone. Out comes the goalkeeper. And Hudavad, just fearless in all aspects, just comes out and gets every bit of the ball and anybody else that's in his way.
Another cross into the box. Oh, this one touched down and a shot. Oh, but Romero slices that one.
Romero's going to wish he had that one back. He's going to fall asleep tonight, whether it be on the bus or at the hotel, either headed back to Martin Methodist or coming back here on Wednesday. He's going to want that one back.
And you saw that collision earlier. That was Hundavad and Alexander, and they're both two big men, and that could have been scary, but they're both fine after that one. Sean Dong, as you mentioned, playing off the shoulder of that last defender, just trying to stay onside for long enough to get a through ball. Now Teixeira swings it out wide. Galbraith is there. Plays it back to Hundavad. And now played out of bounds. It'll be Grandview ball. Grandview just trying to once again settle play down and not panic too much, even though they're down 1-0.
You hit my favorite word there, panic. Can't panic. There's a lot of soccer left to be played in this contest. We saw Ashford go up 2-0 late in the second half. Baker comes back, which there could be a nice debate of which team of Baker and Ashford is better. Did Ashford surprise Baker? Did Baker come back unsurprised? Whatever the case may be, whether you look at the RPI, the seeding, the coaches poll, whatever. But a quality soccer game that went into the second overtime. So more of that here. A lot of good soccer left to be played.
Yeah, and at this point in the national championship, there are no easy games. There are no teams that are pushovers. You've got to fight for everything you get, and we're seeing it again here in this game with only a 1-0 lead for Martin Methodist.
And that's why I thought Grandview would come out and take what is theirs, not to just sit on the sideline and let Martin Methodist fold or roll over, and you guys are the one seed, here it goes, served on a silver platter. No, you're going to get the best effort by every single team. So for Grandview, definitely even keel as of this point, but you're going to have to earn that victory here today.
And an interesting statistic I was just handed by Martin Methodist SID. As of half, Martin Methodist College on a 251-minute shutout streak. Last goal was in the semifinals of their conference tournament against Southern Poly.
That's some good math. How many, what is 200, how many minutes?
251.
Wow.
On the dot.
It's like 4 hours worth of soccer.
That's very impressive. And as you mentioned before, they've got 8 shutouts on the year. They do not allow goals easily. And now a free kick here for Grandview. And standing over it, looks like Johnny McAdam on his left. We'll see if he takes it or steps over it. Oh, and a right-footed shot. And that one, I believe, was one of the center backs.
That's number 7, Aaron Scott. That's not called for there by any means. That ball never had a chance, even remotely close. You've got to put something on frame, put something on the box. That's inexcusable there in the final sight to just blast that ball over the crossbar.
Yeah, Scott, part of that Scottish midfield contingent. He is a center midfielder, and he, along with McAdam, play in the center of the park there. Oh, and this one over the top, and Sean Dong once again trying to get on the end of it. This one cleared away, though, by Grandview. It does find its way out to Lee, and now played back and out of bounds for a Martin Methodist throw. Red Hawks still doing a good job of getting forward despite being a goal up already. Monhey gets a cross off, and that one's flicked into the goal by who else but Sean Dong. In the right position, as he always is.
Dong puts one in the back of the net. Just a phenomenal service to the mouth of the goal. He's standing right at the front door. Puts it in, no hesitation, perfect placement. And Martin Methodist goes up 2-0 here off Dong's 12th goal of the year.
And a fantastic cross by Monhey. He did just enough to find a little sliver of space there on the touchline. And then Sean Dong, the glancing header. And that one's hard to flick to the back post like that. And Sean Dong, not a huge guy. He's listed at 5'10", but with the two center backs who are also around 6', you figure he wouldn't beat him to that, but he did.
Again, he just has a knack for space. I said this earlier. He's just able to move and manipulate that defense to where he's in the right position at the right time, and that's exactly what he did there again. Monhey picked up, I believe, his second assist of the game, his 10th of the season. So right now, all of a sudden, the Red Hawks go up 2-0 here. And Josh, I'll debate this to you with you for the rest of the 35 minutes, but every soccer coach in America will say 2-0 is the most dangerous lead in soccer. We saw it earlier today. Will we see history repeat itself?
Yeah, and that's exactly what I was telling Todd before, that a lot of soccer players and coaches say 2-0 is the most dangerous lead to have. I'll see if
it
Mark...
It makes no sense to me whatsoever. Because if you take a 1-0 lead, I'll take a 2-0 lead. I guarantee you I win more games than you do.
It's an old soccer cliche. But I guess it holds true, as we saw in the Ashford-Baker game.
But Ashford won.
Oh, good point.
I'm telling you, you got 33 more minutes. I'll go all day.
Oh, and now a free kick here for Grandview. As you're talking about Sean Dong before, it's the positional awareness and the tactical knowledge.
You can't teach it. You can't coach it. He just knows how to play the game.
Exactly.
Knows where to be at the right spot at the right time.
This one will be played in. That's Aaron Scott, who actually served that ball up almost over the netting on that free kick before, and he'll send another one in. Scott, into the box. Back post. Good-looking ball, but no one's there. Ramon.
Yeah, much better adjustment there by Scott. Glad to see him not mailing the second one as well.
Ramon with the ball to Sean Dong. He falls down. That gives Galbraith a chance to track it down. But Sean Dong, a tireless worker, running across the defenders of Grandview and giving them pressure.
I'd hate to think Coach Clary had something to do with it, bringing him off the field with about 12 minutes left to go in the first half, saving his legs, keeping him fresh, knowing the threat that he has in Dong.
Oh, and this one, run forward here by Grandview, but again played away. Martin Methodist just so solid in the back.
Again, we saw it in the first half. Martin Methodist just can't boot things forward here. I know you're an hour into this game, and you've got one sitcom TV show left to play here. You can't just hold on. You just can't play cross-country kickball. You have to have a purpose with every pass.
And now, on the right side, the right back. Play it forward. Martin Methodist once again clears it away in the direction of Dong. Now Monhey with it on the wing.
And again, Dong's not your guy on the first pass. It's the second one. It's the flick. It's the settle and dish. That's the target you want to find, number 10, not the clearance from the back.
And this one, oh, into the box, Christofferson. Oh, and he gets it. That was Romero with the shot, but it's cleared away.
Romero had a great left foot there. Every other player in the country would overthink that. Stop, settle, come back to his right, and you lose that ball. But he hits it, his initial shot with the left foot, and at least put something toward the goal.
About to come on for Martin Methodist is number 20. And that's his first action of the game, I believe. And Mamadou Diaw checking on for them.
Diaw's going to provide some quality minutes here for the Red Hawks. Don't know if he'll finish this contest, but he is going to chew up some minutes for sure. and can't have a letdown here.
Oh, and a shot from outside, and that was Raymond, the Frenchman, and that was a long shot. That was from about 35 out.
That ball had some serious pace on it. We don't have the sort of technology, but miles per hour, I would love to know what that ball was moving. A straight line, an absolute rocket, and it didn't knuckle. You know, he hit the back of that ball, had backspin on it, kept it below the crossbar there. It didn't miss by much, as every goalkeeper sees that ball coming at him, and it gets on top of him in a hurry. And luckily enough, it was wide of the post there for Grandview.
Madrigal, he was possessing there, but Grandview almost got it back. It'll go out of bounds for a Martin Methodist throw. Make sure to check out more exciting action of other NAIA national championships by going to www.naia.org. The men's soccer and volleyball national championship is available now. Go to the NAIA website for more information. And we do have an exciting NAIA championship on our hands this round of 16. Grandview out of Iowa against Martin Methodist out of Tennessee, and Martin Methodist doing a great job so far, up 2-0.
Martin Methodist has played some of the top teams in the country, and I don't know if it's luckily or unluckily for them. They all come from their conference. I mean, there's just a laundry list of teams that are national caliber opponents.
Monhey to Romero. Oh, and a turn and shot by Dong. That was a quick turn. Able to get around that one, but deflected out. Grandview scrambling. Oh, and a miscommunication there between Diao and the right back, Dunleavy. Now played all the way back, and that's just going to be cleared out by Stephen Lunny. Another collision in midfield, but Grandview collects it. McAdam gets it back. Now they just look to settle down. Machizu gets it back to McAdam. And once again, Martin Methodist doing enough to keep Grandview out. Grandview's got a reset here. D'Souza. Back to Galbraith. They'll get it to McLevy. But he's forced to go back again. This Martin Methodist defense just too stout right now. And again, they cut it out. Dunleavy gets it forward, and now they play it in the direction of Dong, and he's chasing after it. And he does get there. He's taking it into the box. He's got space, and he takes a shot, and that's a goal! Sean Dong with another one! And that is a fantastic play by Sean Dong.
My man, Sean Dong. It's his 13th goal of the season. Adds number 2 and 3 here in this game alone, and all of a sudden, does the glass slipper fit for this Martin Methodist team here? Under 30 minutes left to play, but they have to be smiling brightly here as Grandview now has a deer in the headlights look.
Hey, if you're filling in your bracket right now, you might want to start penciling in Martin Methodist to go.
Entries were due last night.
No more today, huh?
No more today. All bets are off.
But again, Sean Dong just getting things done up top, as he has done all year for this Red Hawks team. And Grandview now really has to push forward.
I don't know if it's full-fledged panic mode, but Grandview's in definitely scramble mode right now.
Kenton with the corner. He gets it to McAdam. Crosses one in. Now back to Lee. Tries to get one in. But again, Martin Methodist, I mean, they've been so solid all game long. It's hard to imagine they would give up a 3-goal lead unless Grandview does something really spectacular.
Well, it's not luck that they've won 15 games this season in the Southern States Conference. You talked about that last goal they gave up against Southern Poly. Southern Poly was a top 10, at times top 5 team all year long. Southern Poly's not here because of Martin Methodist in winning that conference tournament. Belhaven, last year's national champion, they beat in the conference tournament this year. You just go right on down the list here. I mean, they played Belhaven in a regular season, beat them. Auburn-Montgomery, right across the street here. They're a top 10 type team. I mean, up and down this schedule, they just play quality opponent after quality opponent. So when they show up as the RPI's 16th number, you think, man, it's just a number. It's what you've done to prepare yourself for this moment, and clearly the Redhawks have cashed in on this effort.
And that can be due to the coaching. And Jerry Cleary has prepared this team well. You can tell they have found what Grandview likes to do and just countered it perfectly. And countering that, oh, and a stoppage in play here, and looks like a player's going to get a card for talking to the referee.
Yeah, this is an interesting sequence here. Mark Methodist thought they were held by, I believe it was number 10, or no, I'm trying to find a number. Here we go, McGowan. McGowan thought he held number 14 there, and Maurig, I'm sorry here, I'm fumbling my numbers and my names here. Mark Methodist thought they were fouled. Referee said he was not. Number 14 had something to say back, and the referee just had a little counseling moment there.
Yeah, and that's
fill in the gaps if you can.
That's Juan Madrigal.
Thank you. That's what I was looking for.
Who was talking to the referee a little bit there, and he'll just call him over and say, well, you don't need to be giving me advice. I am the referee. And the referee is, oh, if I can find my name here, as I've misplaced it. Referee is Griff Sims, the head referee. Now Grandview just looking to find something here. They play it wide, but Machizu can't track that one down. Coming back on for the Vikings is number 24, Austin Kelly. He checked on in the first half. Oh, but no sub yet, as it is the Red Hawks throw.
You talk about filling out your bracket, or at least flipping the real one upside down here. Four games played today, four games played tomorrow. That's the round of 16 to get us to the quarterfinals on Wednesday. So the way the bracket shapes up, they try to reward the teams with an extra day off. The top seeds will play today, getting a day off tomorrow, and then playing on Wednesday. Now, the one seed isn't going to play on Wednesday, and now you take this Martin Methodist team, which would have had the toughest draw in this entire bracket. Now they get a day off tomorrow. They get to come here tomorrow, see all other eight teams left in this tournament tomorrow, and they're just going to ooze with confidence as it leads up to kickoff on Wednesday.
And tomorrow they would get to watch Mid-America Nazarene and Bellhaven, the Tuesday 1:30 game, and that is the team they would play against next.
And if you're Mid-America or Bellhaven, you want nothing to do with the team that just beat the number one team in the country.
Yeah.
Because they got nothing to play for. They got no ambition. They just throw it in the wind, and they're just ears back, nose down, and just full force ahead. It's going to be a tough train to stop.
Yeah, and you can tell by the way they've played, the entire team is just amped to be in the national championship debate. And Sean Dong, what can you say about the guy?
And Josh, you know as well as anybody, it may not be about upsets and seeds. It's about matchups. And clearly today, Martin Mathis matches up really well with Grandview. Do they have a team built for a national championship? Most would say no. And most would say, the other half would say, we'll find out, you know. And then the Martin Mathis folks chime in and say, well, why not us? We just beat the number one team. And what the great part about it is, everybody would be right. And we get to find out the rest of the week who the best team in the country is.
And that's the beauty of it. We get to see every game, how it shapes out and which teams get the edge. Now Raymond coming down, left wing, crosses one in. Sean Dong's in the area, but it's headed out of there by number 5.
Sean knew it, too. You can see him giving the thumbs up to his teammate. He found that vacated spot to the back post. The cross was delivered just a little bit short, and he kind of has that extra body to the meter hopping up and down like we missed another one. But he gives him a thumbs up to his teammate. Hey, right idea.
Yeah, and Dong was open on that back post, too. He could have had himself another one. Headed out by Christian Quiñones. And now Raymond to swing another one in. And he's been dangerous on that left wing. He and Dong hooking up very well. Now swung in there. Back post. And there's a man in the area. Oh, but that's just out the outside of the net.
That didn't miss because of effort, for sure.
And that looked like Romero, who had the first goal, who headed that one. And his first goal was a header as well, so we already know that guy can get to some headed balls. Now played forward. But Martin Methodist again just clearing it away. In the NAIA, student-athletes stand for something when they compete. Integrity, respect, responsibility, sportsmanship. As this one swung into the box. Ooh, and a shot and tipped over the bar. And Lunny had to just get a hand on that one. That was the newly checked in Austin Kelly on the shot. And he got it. It was a as a volley kind of floated up there, and he took a shot at it. And Grandview looking to claw back into this one. Swung into the box, back post. There's a man there, but it's headed over. And that was Quiñones again getting on the end of it, but just wide.
Let me get this straight. If you're Grandview, you've got to finagle the defense that's only given up a couple dozen shots on goal all season long. And then even if you fight through the teeth of the defense, you've got to put a ball on frame that gets past that save.
That was fantastic.
By the way, you could do it at least three more times.
And that one, I mean, that was a well-struck shot, and that's just a reflex save.
Wow.
Fantastic. And just enough to tip it over the bar. Steven Lunny, can be said one of the best keepers in the country at the NAIA level, as he's here in the tournament.
Well, I think there's a common theme amongst all these teams. There's no bad goalkeepers left
yeah,
in this
exactly.
tournament. You have to have quality goalkeeping, A, to win games, and B, to win a national championship. So the fact that you're here, you have a quality goalkeeper.
Teixeira checked on for the Red Hawks during that corner kick, and now it's tipped off of him. Before that shot, let me finish my NAIA read here. It's the In the NAIA, student-athletes stand for something when they compete: integrity, respect, responsibility, sportsmanship, and servant leadership. Learn more about the NAIA and its Champions of Character program at NAIA.org, as that one shot, but Lunny again there. Didn't have to do a lot on that one. Little bit of less spectacular save.
I believe he'll get credit for his third save of the game there, but for sure that's a back pocket save.
Oh, and this one forward, and Sean Dong almost got on the end of another one.
He was a half a step offline there. That ball, he wanted it flicked more toward the outside of the penalty area there, you know, on his left foot, but that one just flicked straight on toward the goalkeeper, and he just got caught on the wrong side.
Now played forward. Christofferson heads one forward. Now Romero, another flick, and Dong down to him. Oh, and Dong, look at all that space on that side. Oh, and Romero almost fouled him. Now Grandview looking to possess. They get it out to Machizu. Played forward. Trying to find the winger on the other side, but he does not. Now played forward, and Dong's onside. Keeper's got to come out and clear it, and he does well.
Heads up ball all the way around there for both Hudavad and Dong. Dong didn't do anything crazy. Going cleats up. You're already up 3-0. You don't want to get hurt. You don't want to pick up a card here in this situation, but a cool, calm, and collective clearance there by the goalkeeper.
And we would like to thank Bonefish Grill, one of this year's broadcast sponsors. Bonefish Grill, located at the shops at East Chase right here in Montgomery. Enjoy spinach bacon, gorgonzola, Atlantic salmon, grilled steak, and lobster duet, or, of course, the ever-popular Bang Bang Shrimp. Again, that's Bonefish Grill, located at the shops at East Chase. That's right here in Montgomery.
You got to quit doing that. I'm getting hungry.
Yeah, we have food right behind us that was brought in during the first game, and that was tempting during the game, let me tell you. Now Raymond, hungry for more goals for this Red Hawks team, comes down the line. But it's cleared back to Hundevard.
All right, if you're the Red Hawks here, you think you got one eye on the soccer ball and the other on the scoreboard here in this situation?
Yeah, you would figure with this much time left, don't have much to do other than to ride it out as Dong is flagged for offside.
Good step and a half there, for sure.
Yeah, the pass came a little late from his attacking midfielder, Romero, and he couldn't hold his run for long enough. Now Alexander with it. Plays it into D'Souza. And he takes a long shot. And that one past the post, though, it'll be a goal kick for Martin Methodist. And they'll take the shots from that distance.
Absolutely, especially down three. You just got to let it fly at this point.
Now checking back on, he was in the first half, is Michael Fulton. The big Scotsman, 6'4 to be exact.
Yeah, this is going to be a strategic change here for Martin Methodist. Dong's going to drop back just a little bit into the midfield here. Fulton's just going to be a target guy, and they're going to feed the big man, and he's literally going to try to take the air right out of that ball, step on top of it, and just kill that clock.
And Monhay checking out for him. Just about 17 minutes and 20 seconds left. If you're Martin Methodist, you just got to hold on.
That clock cannot run any faster if you're Martin Methodist. Even up 3 goals. I mean, if it's 1-0, it's going to drag on forever. But even up 3, you're going to look up at that clock every 12 seconds, it feels like.
And if you're Grandview at this point, you just need to get some sort of a goal from anywhere. Crosses into the box, deflections. Just got to hope for something. D'Souza tries to get it over, but Dong, who's been everywhere today, intercepts that one. Pass is sprayed, though. And Grandview will get it back. McGowan plays it forward, but Dunleavy with a clearance.
So that strategy that we kind of critiqued Martin Methodist for twice already with the cross-country kickball, if you will, I think that policy is installed now for Martin Methodist. Just go ahead and kick this ball as far away from your goal repeatedly as much as possible.
Yeah, that's exactly right. At this point, you got to park the bus in front of the goal and just anything's a clearance, just like this one, cleared out.
Love the move there by Laney. Didn't do too much with it. You think you'd want to be a hero there. Let the defense play in front of you.
Oh, and Redmond getting on the end of one. Oh, and he almost had another one for the Redhawks. A great ball over the top by Raymond.
Udvide keeps this game at 3-0 there. He gets his paws on it, comes away with a save.
Yeah, good job to slide out there and just get anything he could on that one as he handles this one that comes in from a long ball. Hundavad. The clearance upfield to McAdam. And that was Madrigal climbing over his back. Now the Vikings from here definitely going to put it into the box and see if they can get a header goal of them for themselves. And Scott with the ball in. Bouncing around in the box, still in the area. McAdam drops it to D'Souza. Dong on him, but D'Souza gets it. And cleared away, and Dong just pokes it forward in the direction of Raymond. And that one's one back. That's good work by Aaron Scott. And he plays one in now. Once again, propelled away from the goal, though, by the Martin Methodist Redhawks. Into the box, but that one will go over the end line, and that'll be a goal kick. And subs for Grandview about to come on.
A little counter substitution here. This is obviously a philosophy change as well for Grandview. They're going to substitute out two defenders here, bring in two more goal scorers off the bench here, and this is going to be kind of a Hail Mary attempt here. Get numbers and bodies forward.
Yeah, and Reeshoos and McLevy are both listed as forwards on their roster, so they're just looking to throw everything forward now. Oh, and now a mistake here, and that one's poked just wide of the goal. And that was Fulton getting on the end of it, but the center backs just got caught out of position.
So when you cut your defense in half, your responsibilities are doubled by the two center backs there, and both have forgot to take on that duty, and Fulton split the two of them there and almost put number four in the back of the net.
Yeah, and one of the outside backs checked off for one of those forwards who came on, so looks like only playing with three listed defenders now are the Grandview Vikings. And those three doing a lot. And the outside defender, number 19, Machizu, is just going to try and get forward as much as possible as well.
Yeah, Machizu can get forward too as well. Good speed, good ball handler as well, strong right foot. So look for him in these overlapping runs to the outside here to try to get some crosses forward.
Grandview gets it back now. McAdam settles it down. And now six players forward in the attacking third for Grandview as it swung around to Kiennanos. Ball into the box. That's a good-looking one. But once again, the Redhawks get it out of there. Oh, and now Raymond with some fantastic footwork, but he has no options and just cleared upfield. Alexander gets it forward. Gets it back now. Now serves one in. That one's going long. And Stephen Lunny will just collect that one And other than the one fantastic save, he hasn't had a ton to do today, which is a testament to the defense.
Yeah, absolutely. Lundy does a great job there. He's really not pressing. He's letting the defense work in front of him here. Doesn't have to be the hero. He realizes that high ball. He's got room to work, comes out and secures it.
And Fulton again. They get it forward to him, and he tracks it down. Oh, and now Sean Dong with an absolutely brilliant volley.
My man Sean Dong with a hat trick here. Picked up his 14th goal of the season, a one-timer, picks it up right off the turf. It's his third hat trick of the year, and Martin Methodist will put both slippers on in 12 minutes.
That is fantastic, and that's the goal of the championship so far. We still got a lot of games to play, but that was absolutely incredible volley.
Well, the best moment, obviously, is Ashford's winner in the second overtime golden goal, but in terms of style points and highlights,
oh my goodness,
there's number one so far.
And Dong, what a way to cap off a hat trick. That is just...
That is a delicious-tasting cherry right
there.
Oh, my goodness. That's the one
goodness.
That goes on top.
And that was out of the air. That one popped up, and he just measured it. Power perfectly into the side netting, and Sean Dong just putting the team on his back.
So if you hear a buzz from Montgomery coming out of this NAIA first day national championship, it's going to be the Redhawks here and Sean Dong not only upsetting the number one seed in Grandview, but doing it in just fabulous fashion style here.
And Austin Kelly takes a shot for the Vikings here, trying to get something back for them. But at this point, I mean, Martin Methodist has defended so well, you don't really see a way out for the Vikings.
Uh-oh.
Oh, and now Fulton getting ahead again. And the Vikings, I'm not sure what they're trying to do, and Fulton gets himself a goal. And the center backs just walked and let him kind of run forward there.
I think reality set in emotionally and physically there with Dong's goal, that was number four. The way it went in, Grandview realized their season's over. It just took the wind out of their sail. Not a whole lot of pep left in the step there, and so Fulton's the beneficiary of that fifth goal there. With Grandview, I mean, just look at the body demeanor right there. There's chins tucked to chest there. Not a whole lot of eyeballs looking on the horizon there. And just a terrible way to finish the season for Grandview here with such high expectations and hopes. They had a phenomenal opening round contest. They just had a ton of potential. They just had a national championship in sight. Beat Bellevue 4-3 in the opening round, and now 5-0 deficit at the hands of the 16 seed.
Martin Methodist just looked like they had the momentum coming in, brought a lot of energy, and showed it from the start. And Fulton gets himself a goal. He's had a couple of chances this game, but he, Dong, and Romero all on the score sheet, and Dong, of course, with the hat trick. Now Grandview getting it in the corner, just trying to save face at this point. They get one in, but once again cleared away by Martin Methodist.
I just want to make sure I got this straight. So Dong scores 3 goals here today, and it sounds like he now has 14 on the season. So he has scored 9 of his 14 goals in 3 games. So it means to tell me the scouting report's out. Target Sean Dong here, keep him off the scoreboard, and you got hope. If not, he's just going to rattle off goal after goal after goal, and you can get back on the bus and go home.
And it was interesting to see the change in philosophy from the coaching staff of the Redhawks. They moved Sean Dong to that target forward position, not to win the balls, but to get it wide first, get balls into him, and kind of get that second ball or the through ball to him. And he thrived in that position.
Apparently. 3 goals in 1 afternoon, not a bad day at the office.
And that last strike was just absolutely stunning.
I don't know how much the $450 million in scholarship the team's absorbing for Martin Methodist, but it's worth every penny today for Coach Cleary and company.
Now coming forward is Machizu. Gets it wide to McLevy. Gets one in, but cleared out of there by the Redhawks, as they've done all day, and they'll hope to keep that shutout.
Josh, we're supposed to know what we're talking about, and I'll admit when I'm wrong. I was wrong about this game. I did not see this one coming like this.
Yeah, and with Grandview's record coming into this game, you'd figure they would be ready for this game, geared up for it.
Let me ask you this question. We knew we had the best 16 teams here in the NAI based on seedings and somewhat the higher teams advancing here to the final site. But did this tournament just get bigger in terms of number of teams that can win this championship? Not to the fact that there's just an upset here, but maybe we short-sighted the top half of the teams that are here, thinking there's only four, maybe five teams mm-hmm. that win a national championship of the 16, and now there's a dozen teams that could win this national championship?
And we talked about that a little bit before, around halftime, how there's a lot of parity in between these teams. There's not a huge gap in between the top ones and, you know, those middle top teams. I mean, anybody can compete as long as they have a really good day. And Martin Methodist has a really good day going right now.
I think what I've learned, and I think I had a clue, I've seen a bunch of Southern States teams this year already. Obviously, everybody knows about Belhaven. People are learning about Martin Methodist. But now you look at AUM, Auburn Montgomery, literally campuses across the street here. We're playing in their backyard, and you think you know how good they were. Maybe they're better than what you thought here, and their stock goes up because they play in the Southern States Athletic Conference.
Yeah, and it's just been a very impressive game here by the Red Hawks, and I can say I didn't expect it either. I thought it would be a close game, especially when it was only 1-0 at halftime, and Grandview has just been beaten.
Again, I'll be the first to admit, if you had told me at 1 o'clock this afternoon that this game was going to be 5-0, I'd have said, yeah, that sounds about right. But not this way. Not Grandview with the goose egg.
Yeah.
And Martin Methodist with a 5 spot.
Mamadou Diaw checking back on as the Red Hawks just look to ride the rest of this one out. Student athletes come first in the NAIA. Their needs, desires, and ambitions guide our every decision. They are the inspiration that drives us to make character a core component and benefit of all intercollegiate sports. Register to get in the game at NAIA Eligibility Center at playnaia.org. And if you're a high school player watching some of these teams at home, you might sign up with Martin Methodist after this game, because
why not?
You can tell they can play.
They call home right there in the middle of Tennessee, so if you're in the region, give Coach Crilly a call.
Now, Hundavad, who's had to pick the ball up out of his own net a fair few times this game, plays one forward. Now, in midfield, Grandview just playing around as they have done all game.
I'm going to have to look this one up, and I don't normally like to tip my hand, but I definitely want to shed light to how far this Red Hawks team has come. But I think in the coaches' poll, they're the 15th-ranked team in the country. Matter of fact, I know that. This could be the highest they've been ranked all year. So somewhat, not necessarily coming out of nowhere, but, I mean,
it's a testament to how well they played at the end of this year.
You're probably right, because Grandview's been the number one team for the most number of weeks.
Well, and this one getting through, that's Rehus getting on the end of it, but got his pocket picked by the defenders from the Red Hawks there. Played forward. And once again, crowded off the ball are the Vikings. And now Red Hawks have 4-on-3 here.
I would sit on the ball. I would literally stop it and just park right on that ball.
And Diaw gets forward. Plays it in. Over to the right side. And now played in again by Raymond. Oh, and Diaw was on that back post. But the Vikings collect it and see if they can get one goal back before the end of this game.
One goal's not going to matter. You need 5 in 5 minutes.
Rehus with the ball. Now played around. And now played forward. And the Red Hawks sitting on the ball right now and just playing it forward in the direction of Fulton. But at this point, both teams know their fate, and for Grandview. A great overall season, but disappointing to end it this way.
19 wins. They're looking at number 20 today, and 20 wins for a soccer team is just unheard of. Some basketball teams in the NAIA don't win 20 games, much less a soccer team that could be the best team. Could have been the best. I'll say it. They're the best team in a regular season, but it doesn't count for a whole bunch here today or for this week.
Yeah, it's not about.
Josh, you and I both live off storylines. You know, mm-hmm. we do research and we present the information as best we can. And I know for me, I was hoping to get through tomorrow with my no Cinderella invite here to Montgomery, and it's been gone after just the second game.
Yeah, the way I would have penciled it in, I thought Ashford was a good team and they were going to get a fairly good win. But that was closer, as that one's cleared away as Dunleavy heads it out. That one was closer than I thought it would be. And then this game I would have put in Grandview if you were to pencil in someone.
And again, depending on what you believe in, do you believe in the RPI or do you believe in the coaches poll?
Yeah, exactly.
The coaches poll has Baker ranked higher than Ashford. But yet Ashford has the higher seed because of RPI. And mm-hmm. so that game didn't surprise me all that much here. Haven't seen Ashford play earlier this year. It's probably one of the worst games they played all year. But this one you wondered, you know, is the Southern States really that good, or is they just beat up on each other, you know? But clearly that question's been answered, and so one storyline becomes another here, and so maybe we have a Cinderella team, and we may also have the toughest conference in the country in the Southern States, and we'll see how they develop not only today but tomorrow as well.
Yeah, it definitely shows how strong the Southern States Conference is. And I'd like to see how the rest of their teams do in this tournament as well. As Lunny collects that one. About 1:50 left on the clock here.
We'll see Belhaven tomorrow at this same time. We'll see Auburn-Montgomery tomorrow night, 6:30. I mean, to see three Southern States teams advanced when there's only eight teams left, you got to like your chances only because of familiarity. You know you're going to run into a team that you played maybe once or twice already this season, and so now it becomes a chess match and something you're familiar with versus seeing a team like Grandview and all you know is what you can scrounge up on tape in a short amount of time and same stats that we're looking at, the other coaches are looking at. You try to paint the picture to your team the best you can, and then you get here to Montgomery after – you know, probably a day and a half of travel, a practice session, and then you wake up, hey, it's game day, and now all of a sudden you got a shot to win a national championship.
Yeah, and as a coach, the only thing you have to go by is either other coaches who have played that team who you know, or tape, or stats that we see. So, and again, Martin Methodist prepared exceptionally well. As the ball goes in here, trying to get it to Fulton.
And it was just, and I think more so than anything else, it was just a bad matchup. Just a bad matchup for Grandview. They definitely didn't want to see. They didn't match up well. This Martin Methodist team's play on the perimeter. I think if you match Grandview up with any of the other teams here at the national tournament, they probably win. Nothing's a guarantee, but obviously the better matchup has played here.
The player down here. So we get some more interesting information from the SID. About 10 seconds to go here. And that'll make it Martin Methodist with the win. That's their first ever win over a number one program. And that makes it 10 consecutive wins for them now. They are hot, red hot, the Red Hawks. And that's it. Martin Methodist with the win. And an absolute demolition by them today.
Yeah, don't adjust your settings on your computer. You're hearing this right. Martin Methodist 5, Grandview 0. The Vikings fall short of 20 wins. They fall short of their national championship hopes, and they fall short here versus Martin Methodist. Meanwhile, red hot, Cinderella, whatever words you want to use, I believe there's another group of Red Hawks coming from Orange Beach, Alabama season who might be coming to a close. I wonder if they'll stop in here in Montgomery on Wednesday and perhaps cheer on their counterparts. So this Martin Methodist bandwagon may get a little bit bigger here in Montgomery before week's end.
Yeah, and the best player for the Martin Methodist Red Hawks was Sean Dong, and I'm definitely on his bandwagon after that game. What a hat trick. And the last volley, just absolutely incredible. Hopefully you can watch that one back if you get a copy of the games. And, oh, man, that was definitely on the highlight reel.
That'll be definitely good money worth spent there buying the DVDs. Thanks to Turbo Sports and the guys for putting it together. And it's just a phenomenal effort on their part. Can't say it enough here. Martin Methodist advancing to the round of eight, which will be played on Wednesday.
Yep, and with that, Martin Methodist 5, and again, final score for Grandview 0. You did read that correctly on your screens. And they Martin Methodist will match up with either Mid-America Nazarene or Belhaven in the next round. Belhaven and Mid-America Nazarene, both tough teams. And Select Sport. The Select Super Elite is the official soccer ball of the NAIA. Select Sport America is the proud sponsor of both the NAIA Men's and Women's National Soccer Coach of the Year and Player of the Year Awards. NAIA member schools are provided the opportunity to participate in the Select Sport Ball Adoption Program, where a percentage of all Super Elite sales are donated to the NAIA Champions of Character Program. Please contact your local dealer for more information on the finest hand-sewn soccer balls in the world. Select Sport America, the official soccer ball of the NAIA. Turbo Sports Group, the official video production company of this year's national championship, and as we mentioned before, they have video downloads available for you. Visit TSG online at www.turbosportsgroup.com, and of course Bonefish Grill. We'd like to thank them, and it's located at the beautiful the shops of East Chase Shopping Area. Bonefish Grill has the best holiday gifts available. When you buy $100 in gift cards, receive a $20 bonus card. For more information, stop by the Montgomery location or visit online at www.bonefishgrill.com. And you have listened to the live broadcast of the NAIA Men's Soccer National Championship from Montgomery, Alabama, which has been brought to you by the NAIA and New Lion, the NAIA's official video stream provider. Check back on www.naia.org for more information and more exciting live video streaming action. Again, this has been Josh Brown, joined by Matt Mahoney, my color commentator. Thanks again to the production crew. Next game up is Lindsey Wilson versus Indiana Wesleyan. We'll hope you'll tune in for that.